We are here tonight to pledge never forget. I would like to thank Dr. Ken Bees to initiate for me being here tonight. My name is William Harvey. I was born in the Czech Republic in 1924. I want to give you a little geography where I come from, also some history. Before 1918, this part of the world was known as Austro-Hungarian monarchy. After 1918, Russia took it over. They didn't behave themselves too well, so the people chased them out. In 1919 became the Czech Republic under the president of Garrick Tomáš Masaryk. The Czech Republic definitely was real democracy. Matter of fact, they used to call them Little America. They were very advanced in technology. The Czech Republic 1930 and Slovakia united, and that's why they called them Czechoslovakia. My city was called Berehovo, was situated below the Carpathian Mountains. The main industry was, we were growing grapes and making wine, like here in Napa Valley, it was very famous. My father was in the First World War, prisoned in Russia for 6 years. When he came back, he endured an awful lot of beatings. He came back a very, very sick man. He couldn't continue his business. He was in a wine business. Most of the time he was in a hospital in different cities. So I grew up, I barely knew my father, maybe I seen him about 15 times. My city was called Berehovo. The population was approximately 46,000, give and take, maybe one third of them was Jewish. Was surrounded by little farm towns, and there were less Jewish people living. I come from a family of six. I had four sisters and a brother. My mother was a dressmaker, but what I know about her talent today, she was more like a dress designer, extremely talented. She worked under very primitive circumstances. I'm going back 83 years ago when I was practically 8 years old at the time. We had a nice home, but we had no indoor plumbing, there was no electricity, so it was a difficult life, but we didn't know any other way, so we never complained. I always seen my mother sitting by the sewing machine, working so hard. She was determined she gonna educate the six children, and she managed to do so. She never complained, never even went to bed to sleep. She used to go to sleep on the sewing machine. Then I heard the machine going again. So as I said, I wasn't quite 8 years old. Since I can remember it, I always never worried about myself. You could say that I was born to be an adult. I always just thought about it, how could I help her that she shouldn't have to work so hard. I was a very particular child, I liked to look clean, so I used to wash my own clothes, I used to iron it. It was voluntary by me, I didn't want to burden my mother with it. When I was age of 10, I decided to go and work in the vineyards. The vineyards was situated approximately about a half a mile from house. I was able to work there. In the springtime, I used to work there to cultivate the growth of the grapes. In the fall, they used to harvest the grapes. The grapes wasn't growing in a flatland, it was growing toward the mountain, so it was very special. The first time they put the backpack on me, made out of very, very heavy wood, ordered to carry the grapes from the mountain to the winery. But I collapsed, I was in pain, I didn't dare to cry because I didn't want to lose my job. And my colleagues was very, very kind to me, and they showed me how to carry the heavy wooden backpack with the grapes to the winery. So I was so happy that I was able to earn some money to help my mother. Things was extremely bad all over in Europe. The anti-Semitism started to flourish, particularly in Germany. Hitler was coming to power. Naturally, the communication wasn't like it is today. I didn't even own a radio, but somehow we managed to hear, like example, my mother had a friend in Berlin, and her 19-year-old son escaped the prosecution and came through our town, stayed with us for 3 days, and was telling us how they were killing the Jews. Hitler was coming to power, they were confiscating their property, they were burning the Jewish literature. So that's the way we managed to hear. In 1936, I was age of 12, and I heard Hitler speak on the radio to the world, and he said, I'm gonna kill every Jew in this world. If I don't succeed to kill every Jew in this world, I make it sure the one who remains alive never gonna be happy. Doesn't matter what part of the world they gonna live in, because they gonna lose some member of their family. Why? He said, there is no why. The Jews are guilty when they born. So you can imagine, ladies and gentlemen, I was 12 years old. Life was difficult as it was. I was fairly intelligent, tried to define and to make some sense of it, why I was considered to be second-hand citizen. I felt I was just as good as anybody else. Naturally, we didn't take it seriously, because we depended on Great Britain. They were the power, the dominant power in Europe at the time, you know. We depended on them not to stay silent, but unfortunately all the world stood silent, and a twisted ideology like Hitler were able to destroy even his own people. Now you ask, why do they use the Jews? The Jews was always the minority. There is over 1 billion people in India, over 1 billion people in China. There is only 14 million Jews in the whole world. Germany was in a very difficult economic situation. They were extremely advanced, creating war machines to kill people, tanks and aeroplanes. But their land wasn't even fertile enough to grow potatoes. So Hitler decided he's gonna take over other countries, steal everything out, and this way he can satisfy his people and he'll be able to destroy the world. We never dreamed in a 20th century when the people had the highest education, they were gonna allow the madman's ideology succeed. In 1938, Neville Chamberlain was the English Prime Minister. He decided to come to negotiate with Hitler in Munich. He told if he gives in to Hitler, Hitler will not attack England, but Hitler never kept his word. He attacked England anyway. I lived that century, and I remember it real well. That was the biggest mistake. I feel that he created the whole Second World War, because Hitler had no means to continue with the war if Chamberlain wouldn't allow him to proceed. So, out of the negotiation, they cut out Czechoslovakia. The part where I came from was given to Hungary. Part of Romania was given to Hungary. The Sudeten part of Czechoslovakia was given to Germany. In 1939, we became under Hungarian occupation. Soon as they came to town, the Hungarians were very anti-Semitic people. They are even, the anti-Semitism is even flourishing today in Hungary. In 1941, the Hungarian government decided that only 6% of the Jewish children were able to pursue their education. The education runs a little different in Europe than in the United States. When you finish the sixth grade of elementary school, You have choice to go to high school, which 4 years. If you were capable to pass an SAT test, you were able to enter the gymnasium. Gymnasium was 8 years. Then you graduated at the age of 18 from a gymnasium with equivalent to 2 years of college credit, because we took so many more units than you take here in high school. Well, I was fortunate enough to fall into the 6%. I graduated at the age of 18 from a gymnasium, but unfortunately my graduation present became Birkenau Auschwitz. Birkenau was the exterminating camp, consisted of all the crematoriums and the gas chambers. Auschwitz was the concentration camp. In 1943, Russia and Germany was in war. Around December 1943, we became under German occupation. By the way, the Hungarians were very willing collaborators with the Germans. As soon as they came to town, they immediately sent out the Jewish people. They made us wear a yellow star. That's the only way we were able to walk out of the house. We felt very humiliated. People made fun of us. We had a very difficult time to deal with. Not too long afterward, they decided to establish a ghetto in a city. We had a factory which was manufacturing red bricks to build buildings. When the brick came out of the oven, it had to dry, so they had a long place, had a roof farm, there was no side, that's where they would store the brick to dry. So first they decided to pick the people from the little farm towns, because less Jewish people was living there. Without any notice, they went and knocked on their door. They gave them 5 minutes that they can pick any position, but they wanted to bring with them in 5 minutes. You can imagine the people was very upset. Their parents worked for that house for a lifetime to leave the home. They took very little with them. They bore them into that so-called ghetto. They housed them where I described you that the brick would dry. They didn't have warm blankets with them. They had very little warm clothes, very little food to eat. There was young children, old people, babies, sick people, no medical attention. I'm speaking about the year of 1943, around December. This part of the world usually becomes extremely cold. The winter arrives around November. We receive a tremendous snow. The snow remains till the following year of the spring, around April. So it was very, very cold. All those people was out where I described it before. The brick would dry, they were freezing. We were still in the city. We decided to go to door to door to collect warm blankets, warm clothes, and much food as we possibly can to bring and try to make those people more comfortable. When all the people was collected on the little farm town, then one day they came to my mother's house. They knocked on the door without any notice. My mother, myself, my two sisters was home. My two other sisters emigrated to Brussels, Belgium, in 1933. Now I'm speaking about the year of 1943. We corresponded with my sisters. We exchanged pictures. Both of them got married in Brussels, Belgium. Brussels, Belgium was also under German occupation, so Jews was not allowed to travel in Europe. So as I said, we haven't seen them in the past 10 years. Both of them got married, each had 2 children. So, as I said, my mother, myself, my 2 sisters, my aunts, my cousins, and their children, we were all born into that so-called ghetto. We stayed there for 6 weeks under terrible treatment and sanitation conditions. On the uncertainty to our destiny, things didn't look good, but a human being lives with hope. Never dreamed that a concentration camp exists in the 20th century. After 6 weeks, a lot of people got berserk, and one day the train arrived with all the cattle cars. The sliding door slammed open on the cattle car. They pushed into one cattle car as many people they possibly can. We were crushed like sardines. When the car was filled with people, the sliding door slammed closed on us. There was no windows. The only light came through the wooden cracks of the cattle cars, and suddenly the train stopped to move. I cannot tell you what a difficult journey that was, lasted 4 or 5 days and nights. Without food, children were sick, they had fever, no medication. As I said, things didn't look good, but a human being always lived with some hope. After all that suffering, suddenly the plane stops. The sliding door slammed open. We looked outside, it looked like a twilight zone. We didn't know where we arrived, but we find out soon enough. Protobus was standing in the SS man's uniform, with a German shepherd barking at us. Big chimneys going all over the sky and smoke coming out of it. We didn't know what the smoke is coming from. As I said, we find out soon enough. We arrived to Birkenau, Auschwitz. Birkenau, as I said, was the extermination camp with all the gas chambers and the crematorium. I'm speaking about the year of 1944, the spring of it, when hundreds of thousands of Hungarian Jews was brought into the camp. The mass killing went on. They were killing between 12 and 13,000 people a day. Poland was under German occupation 3 years prior to the Hungarian Jews. So Poland was under German occupation 3 years before, so the Polish prisoners were in the camp already for 3 years. Some of them were there for 2 years. They were working for the Germans by the railroad station. When the German SS stood in front of us, it was hollering, "Schnell, schnell," and "Hurry, hurry, hurry out of the cattle wagon." Who they picked for work, go to the right. Who they picked, condemned to die, young mothers with their children. Older people, when I say older people, 45, 50 years old, go to the left. When the German SS didn't look, the Polish prisoner whispered to the young mother who was holding their children in her arm, "Give your children to the grandparents." They didn't know why, but they knew why. They wanted to save the young mother's life. They knew if she goes to the left with her children, she's going to the gas chamber, to the crematorium. And some of the young mothers were successful enough to give the children to their grandparents. But most of the children was bitterly crying, didn't want to be separated from the mother. So the young mother with her children went to the left, went to the gas chamber, to the crematorium. All the people was ordered to go to the right. They marched us into a big room made out of wood, made us strip completely naked, shaved our hair. They gave us a prisoner suit to wear. They took every little possession that we still had with us, which was very little. And in those days, many people had gold teeth or gold fillings in their mouth. They would yank it out of their mouth. As I said, there were a lot of confusion because, as I mentioned before, that the mess killing went on. We were situated, our room was situated next to, close to the gas chamber. The gas chamber had a little window outside where the SS would look in to see how far the people was dying from the gas. And they used the gas very sparingly because it was you are able to glance in and to see how our loved one was dying. We had no power to do anything. If anybody would open that, there now they would be right away shot to death. They marched us into the Auschwitz concentration camp, which consisted of thousands and thousands of wooden barracks. Each of those barracks was approximately 1,000 square feet. To that 1,000 square feet, they pushed in so many people who were again crushed like sardines. 4 o'clock in the morning, they would knock out to wake us up. We couldn't even sleep. We had to come outside and stand in the rock, or I don't know what was the purpose of it, because nobody could escape. All those barracks was surrounded by barbed wire. The barbed wire was connected to electricity. Anybody would touch it, they would be electrocuted. Every morning when we walked out of the barrack, front of the barrack was naked. Dead people, they looked like skeletons, excess of skin and piled on top of each other so high that I had to look up to see the end of it. And sometimes they were front of the barracks for 3 to 4 days before they picked them up. The reason was, as I said, the mass killing was going on and the crematorium wasn't equipped to take care of that many dead people, so sometimes it took them 3 to 4 days before they picked them up. We got once a day a bowl of soup, they call it, it's about that big. No utensils. 5 to 6 people had to share it, so we handed it to mouth, back and forth until everybody drank from it, until the soup disappeared. And if we were lucky that day, maybe we got a little piece of bread to eat. Being there the 8 days. Next to us was thousands and thousands of patient barracks, and suddenly filled up with people, young and old, babies together, families. I was a little bit envious of them, because as we witnessed what happened to our loved one and all the other people, I happened to speak through the barbed wire to one of the gentlemen who I discovered was born in the same city where I come from. He moved up to the Sudetenland of Czechoslovakia, which was under German occupation. The whole town, the city was called Nidica. They resisted the German occupation, accidentally killed one of their officers. For that reason, the whole town was brought into that camp. He said, don't envy us because we're going to be all killed. Being there already 8 days, and I seen killing left and right. But still, we were in a trance, we were in a denial, we couldn't believe it. Well, 2 days later, we had Blacksperre and curfew. We were locked into the barracks for 2 days or 2 nights. We heard the cries, the yawns, the moans. After 2 days, everything quieted down. They let us out of the barrack. Ladies and gentlemen, 35,000 people perished from the city, from the Sudeten of Czech Republic. The city was called Nidica. Every denomination, Christian, Jews. Being there the 12 days, nobody had a name, everybody had a number tattooed on their arm. There was a shortage with the tattoo, because as I said, hundreds of thousands of Hungarian Jews was coming in. So sometimes you had to stand in line 3 to 4 days before the tattooer was able to come to your arm. Before the tattooer put the number on my arm, the SS came over and pointed out, you come out of the line. It came out of the line, they picked the one who looked stronger to go to work. They packed us again in the cattle car. We traveled without food, I don't know how long. Arrived high up in the Bavarian mountains to another concentration camp called Buchenwald. We arrived there, you have to go through again a disinfecting procedure, they would shave your hair. There was a big tub with very harsh chemical. Everybody had to rush down themselves into the tub on head to toe. When you came out of the tub, you were in pain. Your eyes was burning, your skin was burning, very unhappy. They put us into a cellar, sitting on a cement floor, waiting very unhappy to see what our destiny was going to be from one minute to the other, if they needed people to work that day, you survive. If they didn't need people to work, they would put you in the gas chamber. They wouldn't feed anybody who didn't hurt somebody forever. As I'm sitting on the floor, very, very unhappy, full of pain, suddenly somebody walks into the room and begins to question the people, anybody knows anything, what happened to my family. As he was questioning the other people, as he came closer and closer to me, I discovered my brother-in-law from Brussels, Belgium, who I never met in person. I mentioned it to you that Brussels, Belgium was on the German occupation. So I never met him in person, but I recognized him because he was born into the camp, not as a Jew, as a Christian on the falsified papers. He was a resistant fighter. They brought him in as a political prisoner. And political prisoners, Christians, had better treatment than the Jews, so they elected him to be a couple. Couple meant a foreman. That's the only reason he was able to come into the room, otherwise nobody could walk around freely. And day before, he talked to the transport, the people who came in, and he found out that a lot of people was coming from the part where I come from. So he was hoping to bump into somebody to get some answers, what happened to my family, but never expected to bump into me. But this is destiny in life. Our union didn't last too long. I was there for 6 days before I had a chance to say goodbye to him. They picked us again to go to work. So they packed us again in a cattle cars. We traveled to Dresden, Germany. We came to Leipzig, Germany. Near Leipzig was a city called Lena. Lena had one of the biggest gasoline refineries. The Allies' plane used to come every night and bomb it, and this was taken there to clean up after the bombing. We were housed about 4 miles from the refinery. We were given the wooden sole shoes to wear with a canvas strap. But we weren't allowed to wear the shoes the 4 miles that we have to walk to the refinery, except before we enter to the refinery. We have to tie the shoelaces, put the shoes on our shoulder, march bare feet in the unpaved road, full of stones. Many people's feet got infected. Every day got worse and worse. They had no medical attention. If they couldn't keep up the walking space with the rest of us, the SS constantly was back over and beating them until they died from the road. That lasted for 2 months. After 2 months, they decided they should not walk the 4 miles. They had a vacant lot across from the refinery. They put some tents there, and they housed us in those tents. The Allies' planes used to come night before, draw a white line in the sky. When the white line pointed a certain place, we knew that the bombing on my fall next day. We were looking forward to the bombing, even that the shrapnel from the bomb many times came where we were housed in the tents and killed many of us. We preferred to die from the bomb because this may be, we felt that some of us maybe has a chance to be liberated. We were desperate. Some of us to stay in life, to tell, able to tell the world what they were doing. That lasted from the spring of 1944 till about September 1944. By that time, many people were beaten to death. Every day we have to go and lift the heavy iron and the heavy stone, which was by the bombing. And as I said, the shrapnel from the bomb came across the street and many people died from that. The remaining people who remained alive by September, they realized that the refinery cannot put back to working condition under Norway. By September, many people was beaten to death, many people died from hunger, many people died from the bombing. It was approximately about 1,100 left alive, maybe give and take a few more. They realized that this cannot be put back to working order, so they took us to another place to work, high up in a mountain. We were digging tunnels under the mountain, traveling to the railroad station, unloading railroad tracks, bring it to the mountain. It was freezing cold, snowing. We were housed in a horse barn, sleeping on a cement floor. After 6 weeks, a typhus epidemic broke out, half of the people died. The other half was remained to work there. From September 1944, about approximately end of March 1945, I was in a railroad station unloading railroad tracks, and I fall down one of the pits and fall on my right foot, broke three places, never got any medical attention. A couple of days later, with the rest of the people, it was very close to liberation. Buchenwald was liberated by the Americans around April 11th or the 15th. So it was this was end of March, so very close to liberation. They packed the rest of the people to the cattle car, and again we traveled, I don't know how long, without food. We were freezing cold. People was dying left and right. If they died, we took their clothes off to try to keep warmer. By the time I got back to the destination, which was Buchenwald, where I told you that I met my brother-in-law a year before, they came to collect all the dead people from the cattle car to transport them to the crematorium. Buchenwald was liberated by the Americans around, as I said, April 11 or the 15th. So it was very close to liberation. I was frozen, they told I was dead, they put me among the dead people. I arrived to the crematorium, which was worked by the prisoners. The prisoner discovered that I was still alive. 5 days later, I woke up in a barrack, put on the third bunk bed, laying on my stomach on a piece of wood. When I opened my eyes, I thought I was in a five-star hotel. Nobody was beating me, nobody was hollering at me. By that time, I was age of 20. I was 72 pounds. I couldn't even stand up on my feet. And I was told the story, how the prisoner saved my life and why he was able to do it. Being there in a crematory for 1 or 2 days, I witnessed the worst what I had witnessed the whole year and a half that I was imprisoned in a concentration camp with the ghetto all together. Suddenly, about 21 to 23 people walks into the room, naked, bare. It didn't look like human beings. They were missing flesh all around their face, all around their body. They looked like skeleton in a museum who just some skin on. How they walked into them beyond my comprehension. I was told they were traveling in an open cattle car and it was snowing and raining for 6 days. They bitten into each other's flesh, they got deserved. There was pieces of flesh missing all over the body, all over the face. That was the worst. I don't believe that they ever were able to recuperate, but how they walk in beyond my control. A couple of days later, I asked the people to take me outside. I wanted to catch some fresh air. They carried me out, and I hear a French accent, which I recognized. I heard it before, when I was there a year before. My brother-in-law introduced me to one of his friends who was always going into the concentration camp as a Christian, not as a Jew. I was so happy to hear his voice, and I asked him if he knows where my brother-in-law is. He says he's here. He is so happy to know that you're alive. I reunited with my brother-in-law 3 days before we were liberated. He told me, as soon as I can nurse you well enough to travel, I will not let you go back where you come from. You're going to come with me to Brussels, Belgium. That's what I did. I went to Brussels, Belgium. I was recuperating there for 2 months when I got a message from Germany that my two sisters survived. They're staying in a displaced persons camp waiting to go back where we were born. There was a gentleman from Brussels, Belgium, who was also a political prisoner, who brought the message to my sister in Brussels. By the way, my mother, my aunts, my cousins, their children, they all perished in the Auschwitz concentration camp. I haven't talked about my father too much. I told you that he came back from the First World War. He was a very sick man. When we were under the German occupation, 3 weeks prior to us going into the ghetto, my father was walking with a cane, very frail man. They beat him up so badly that 3 days later he died. He was buried in my city, 3 weeks prior to us going into the ghetto. I haven't talked about my brother. My brother was 18 years old and died from 2 doctors malpractice in the city. There was a 15 years age difference. I was the youngest one. So he died. So when I heard that my two sisters got back where we come from, by that time this part of the world was under Russian occupation. It was communism. I didn't want them to stay under communism, so I went immediately to the Czechoslovakian council and I told them, I says, I want to go back and get my sister out of there. I don't want them to stay under communism. The council told me, young man, if you go back in your age, the Russian pick you up on the street and take you to work to Siberia. I said, I'm sorry, I have to take that chance. I convinced him. It was a very difficult journey because Europe was completely bombed out, all the railroad station. Many places I have to walk from one city to the other in order to catch a train, but I managed to get back. I find my two sisters, I also find two of my cousins. We were there 3 days. And then we went up to Prague. Prague was also under Russian occupation, but they said that the Russians were going to leave Prague, they were going to liberate it. After 6 weeks, we seen that the Russians are not going anywhere. We decided we did do under no circumstances we want to stay under communism. They suggested to us if we go back to Germany, we stay in a displaced persons camp, we'd be able to emigrate to some other country. So we went back to Germany. The part of Germany was called Niederbayern. The city was called Degendorf. They housed us previously was the Hitler's youth camp, so we had very nice facilities. I began to work for the UNRWA. The UNRWA was the beginning of the United Nations. So all the food, Red Cross packages came from America. I was responsible to divide the food among the people in the camp there. Then also the city was surrounded by other displaced persons was living. They all came and got the food for me. The camp was called UNRWA 55. I was there from 1945 till 1946. 1946, President Truman put a new amendment called the Truman doctrine to the emigration law that all displaced persons, dates such as the Gentiles in Germany, was able to emigrate to the United States without having to wait for a quota. So I was very happy to hear, because my mother, who you're gonna see right here on the extreme right, is a picture was taken in New York City, 1902. My mother, my grandmother, my mother's two sisters and a brother emigrated to the United States in the 1800s. So my mother, that picture was taken in 1902 in New York City. I assume that my mother went back after 1902 with my grandmother to Europe, but her two sisters and a brother remained in America. We used to correspond with them. They used to send us packages. So I always wanted to come to America. The 31st of August, 1946, I arrived in New York City with an army boat called Marina Birch. I find one of my aunt, the other one was deceased. My uncle was living in California. I was 3 days in America. By that time I was age of 22. I wanted to go immediately to work, earn some big money. My aunt wasn't in such a good financial circumstances, and I was used to work since I was not quite eight, so I didn't worry about it. Little did I knew that I had the language barrier. I didn't speak English, but I spoke five other languages. So my aunt tried to figure out what kind of work could I get where I could learn English, the meantime earn a living. She had a friend who had a place in Manhattan, 719 Lexington Avenue. There is a letter you find there in Nevada. That was a cosmetology place. That was the place of New York City. All the movie stars, the radio city star, the rock city, the Metropolitan Opera, everybody was there in that place. They had about 55 to 60 people working at the time. That was an international shop. They spoke that five other languages, so that my aunt told that it would be a good place for me to learn from them English. I got the job as an errand boy. I was very happy to get the job. My salary wasn't much. Now you're gonna hear all the beautiful things what happened to me in America. Only in America can happen. There is no kinder other people than the American people. I was young, as I said, 22. I was the youngest one in the place. I had some hair, so I was about 2 inches taller. All the ladies gave me, my tip was bigger than my salary. They showered me with very big tips and presents. So I thought to myself, that's a very good place for me to save money. Then I'm going to further my education, but sometimes life and tribulation takes you to a different path than you ordinarily would. But I never regret one day in my life, because I made such a great success out of my life. So I was there for a year. By end of the year, I was no errand boy. Sometimes desperation gives you more inspiration to learn something in a hurry. I didn't know that I had the talent for it. By end of the year, I was able to work on those famous people. Little that I knew that you need a license to practice, and I never went to cosmetology school. But it came very handy that my boss's name, who was called the lady with the golden hand, her husband wasn't in a business, he just handled the business end of it. They also had a place in 42nd Street and Broadway. And his name was Alex Schlesinger. And he happened to have a nephew in the State Department who was head of the State Department at the time. His name was Arthur Schlesinger. That's the way I got my license. Don't tell it to anybody. I was there for 3.5 years. I worked quite a fame. My name was in a paper, I saved up quite a little bit of money. And then in 1950, I decided to come to California to get acquainted with the only living brother my mother had here. He was living in Bow Heights, the east side of the town at the time. I left New York City there with a tremendous winter. I arrived here, the sun was shining, and I took the bus to go to his place, to Bow Heights. I see vegetation, I made up my mind, I'm not going back to New York no more. Little that I knew that my license wasn't valid to practice in California. Just like an attorney, you go to different state, you need new license. But I wasn't afraid for the cosmetology test. By that time, my English was good enough that I would have been able to pass. But California state require that before you can fill up your application, you have to prove that your high school education in the United States didn't matter if you had cards from Europe. Well, I was a very determined young man. My uncle was in the 70s, he had a very sick wife, didn't associate with people, and they didn't have children. But I was determined to stay here. I was hungry to meet somebody, to speak to someone. So, near his house was the Theodore Roosevelt High School, and that was my lucky day when I got there. I met a lady by the name Maria Kilbright. She was teaching the 12th graders. I explained to her my dilemma, how badly I want to stay here, but I have to prove I had high school education before I can apply for my cosmetology license. She told me, she was teaching the 12th graders. By that time I was age of 26. For order for me to go to her class, she had the permission from the principal. So she got the permission and she told me, young man, I'm gonna do everything in my power. You're gonna get your high school diploma, you're gonna get your cosmetology license. And Maria Kilbat was right, wonderful, kind lady. That was my lucky day. I went to her class she got, by the way, the permission from the principal that I should go with the 12th graders. Every day for 3 months I went. At night I went to night school, I bought all the vocabulary book. I came here the 3rd of March, 1950. By September 1950, I had my cosmetology license, I had my high school diploma, and I got a job. I was working on many, many famous people. If I mention the name, way before you were born. One of them was Mary Martin. She was 1947 in the stage show South Pacific in New York City. And one of them, I'm sure that you heard, was Judy Garland, and many, many others. So I got the job. I worked on a job for 2.5 years. After 2.5 years, 1953, I opened my own business, 216 South Robertson Boulevard in Beverly Hills. It was called the Continental House of Beauty. When I opened the door, I didn't have to wait for clientele. They had to wait for me for cancellation. I was that busy. The same year, I was fortunate enough to meet a native Californian young lady who was absolutely beautiful. She was, and I say beautiful, you can see the pictures here, but in those days I wasn't so bad myself. The same evening I met her in the University Synagogue that's situated on Sunset, you know, and around the 405 freeway in that area. I knew that I was going to marry her the same night. 3 months later, we were married on a festival with her, what can I say? We were married for 42 beautiful years. Unfortunately, I lost her from cancer. She was only 62. That was almost 20 years, gonna be 20 years in the 8th of July this month, this year. I had 2 daughters, both went to UCLA. One graduated in 3 years, then she went to Southwestern Law School, she married an attorney. My younger daughter went to UCLA, she majored in psychology. She got her degree, And then she decided not what she had interned in the Pomona Hospital for 6 months, and she got her degree in psychology, then she decided that's not what she wanted to do. So she went for 2.5 more years to USC, and she became a CPA, she married a CPA. My greatest joy and my greatest success is my four grandson. One graduated 6 years ago from Emory College in Atlanta, Georgia, with the highest honor. Immediately, age of 22, he got a job with the Washington Post as an editorial writer. He was very talented. He was in Washington. He was very excited about his job because at that time was President Obama elected, and he interviewed him. Then he also was invited by Dracula, many of his advisors, to the White House. But Grandpa wasn't happy that he's staying with the paper. He was getting $44,000 to come out of college. It was a very good salary, but he likes to live well, and Washington is a very expensive city to live. And then the paper is, this economy was very shaky. I told him he had to further his education. After a year, I convinced him, and he came back. He applied to USC Law School, and he graduated from USC Law School age of 26, that was a little over 2 years ago. His brother, immediately, the first year that he was in law school, he got a very big job in Century City with a very well-known entertainment law firm, and Grandpa was right, his salary was 4 times as more what he was making in the Washington Post. His brother was third year in college. He didn't know which way to go. Then he got inspired by his brother, and he graduated from USC Law School also. I have two younger ones. One is in Stanford, finishing the fourth year. And I have one in high school. They are my greatest joy and my greatest success in my life, because I was always in their life, and I encouraged them for everything. They give me the greatest respect and love. They practically call me every single day. So, as you can see, that I made a tremendous success out of my life. But you come to this world with nothing, and you leave this world with nothing. Earthly wealth don't mean anything if you don't leave some good and impact on your fellow man. Now you ask, how come that I was able to succeed in my life? You wouldn't have time to listen, so the time is too short for me to get into too much, but I give you a little bit. I came to this country with a broken heart and a broken soul, one pair of shoes, but I never felt sorry for myself. First place, I never looked back, and I blamed my parents, what they did for me, what they didn't do for me. They did the best. they knew under the circumstances. I have to learn not to hate my enemies. Hatred destroys a person. To be loved, we all want to be loved, but order to love and give from yourself, I find it far more rewarding. That's worthwhile to live, believe me. Now I have to leave you in my teacher, Maria Kilbride, who I owe my biggest success. In her class, everybody have to memorize for them. Very, very meaningful poem. Was the poet wasn't that well known as Longfellow. His name was Edwin Markham, E-D-W-I-N, M-A-R-K-H-A-M. He was born 1852. He lived to be till 1950, and it goes like this. There is a destiny that makes us brothers. None goes his way alone. Order be put into the life of others, it comes back to our own. And believe me, you Absolutely not. No, I reached, celebrated my 90th birthday, I'm going to be 91, May 20th. I work for the Museum of Tolerance on Pico Boulevard. Already 9 years I'm there. I'm lecturing and teaching how to proceed with life. A lot of people come into the museum. Mostly they come not so much to see the Holocaust, but they have a lot of personal problems. I had received about 800 letters, you know, how I improved their life. So I teach how to proceed with life there. I wake up in the morning and I feel that that's an extra present from God to be here. Life is beautiful. Life is what you make. Destiny is in your palm of your hand, what you want to do with your life. I can surely tell you that. And you have to be wise enough to take the right choices. That's the most important thing. I was never further my education, but I was always thirsty for knowledge. And I always associated with people who elevates me instead of bring me down. You have one life to live. Life is beautiful. Try to live at the richest. Only way it happens if you help the others. There was a famous philosopher who said that the greatest thing a human being can accomplish in this earth if you learn to accept your fellow man. I never thought that I'd be still here and hear anti-Semitism and the killing what's going on all over the world. It's been terrible that people kill instead of love and cannot believe that today the people still stay silent. They're killing the Christians, Muslims killing the Muslims, the extreme Islam is the biggest threat in the world. I am very grateful that Bibi Netanyahu came to the Congress to speak, not to stay silent. Right now, unfortunately, Iran is the biggest threat to the whole free society. They supply all the terrorists to kill people. What joy is in killing? I began my comprehension. Anyway, thank you. It's getting late and I overstayed my hospitality. Thank you for being here and listening to me.
Thank you, Mr. Hari. But I'd like to take this chance if the audience has any questions from you.
Yes, I'd be very happy to answer.
To answer some other questions. Anybody has any questions? Give me 1 second.
Obviously, not surprised by Jews being persecuted, but you were talking about some Christians in the middle of the Jews. I'm wondering why they were after the Christians if the Jews were the ones who were supposed to die. You were saying,
because